Welcome. Thank you for joining us this morning. Before we begin our time of worship, I invite us to pause for a moment, center our souls, our hearts, our ears, listening for the small, still voice of God. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. On this sixth Sunday in the season of Easter, we pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And please be seated for the reading of Holy Scripture.
The first lesson from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 17. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, to an unknown God. What therefore you worship is unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted their times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray together in unison, Psalm 66. Bless our God, you peoples.
Make the voice of his praise to be heard, who holds our souls in life and will not allow our feet to slip. For you, O God, have proved us.
You have tried us just as silver is tried.
You brought us into the snare. You laid heavy burdens upon our backs. You let enemies ride over our heads.
We went through fire and water.
But you brought us out into a place of refreshment. I will enter your house with burnt offerings and will pay you my vows, which I promised with my lips and spoke with my mouth when I was in trouble.
I will offer you sacrifices of fat beasts with the smoke of rams. I will give you oxen and goats.
Come and listen, all you who fear God. And I will tell you what he has done for me. I called out to him with my mouth, and his praise was on my tongue. If I had found evil in my heart, the Lord would not have heard me. But in truth, God has heard me. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, who has not rejected my prayer, nor withheld his love from me.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Now who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated, but in your hearts sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make an accounting for the faith that is in you. Always be ready to make defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey. When God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water, and baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers being made subject to him. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be with you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father. And I will love them and reveal myself to them." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God, amen. Love is love is love is love is love is love is love. This is a line from Lin-Manuel Miranda's acceptance sonnet as he received a Tony Award. Lin is the author of the Broadway hit Hamilton. Other lines from this acceptance sonnet are poignant to our current life in a pandemic, in this season of uncertainty, fear, and anxiety. Hear these words. "When senseless acts of tragedy remind us that nothing here is promised, not one day. This show is proof that history remembers. We lived through times when hate and fear seem stronger. We rise and fall and light from dying embers, remembrances that hope and love last longer. And love is love is love is love is love is love is love. It cannot be killed or swept aside. In conversations with those that I love, parishioners, family, neighbors and friends, I hear a longing that we come out of this pandemic differently, changed for the better, more loving, more patient, kind, and considerate, that we not rush too quickly to the return to the so-called normal way of doing things, that we use this halt in activity and season of isolation to find something deeper within ourselves, deeper within our hearts and souls, to help us love our Creator and God's creation, to love our neighbors and to love ourselves, to love with deeper abandon, conviction, and freedom. Jesus tells us, if we love him, we will keep his commandments. And we know that Jesus' number one teaching, his number one commandment, is love. It must not come to us naturally, as it is mentioned in Scripture over 500 times. Love is important, foundational even, to living a life fully embodied, expansive and expressive of the love of the Trinity that abides in and through us. I have a plaque hanging in my office that says, "Bidden or not bidden, God is present." It reminds me of God's care for me and attentiveness to me, even when I forget to call upon God or forget to acknowledge that holy presence with me. It reminds me that God is where I live and move and have my being. And that is true for each of us. In today's gospel, Jesus promises another advocate, another, implying that Jesus has been our advocate with us. And now that Jesus has ascended into heaven, another advocate, a paraclete, is promised to us. Paraclete is a Greek word that means comforter, helper, consoler. This soul friend is promised to us to be with us always and forever. Linda Fabian Pepe in Theological Stew writes, "The Holy Spirit, who moves and guides and directs us in our being and in our lives, that Spirit is the part of us that assures us that nothing, not even a pandemic, can separate us from the love of God through Christ. Look deeper within you. Look inside, and you will run right into this Spirit that lives and abides in you, because God is there. No matter what you see or think or feel, even when your own actions tell you that God has deserted you, you are never alone. Present in every breath in and in every breath out is the helper, the comforter, the consoler. Not judging you, not fed up with you, but loving you." When you come to understand that, that is the kind of love that God has for you. Then living out Christ's commandment to love one another can come as naturally as breathing, as God in you and you in God. And what does this love look like? Sometimes children say it best. In a research project in 2015, 21 children ages 4 to 8 were asked to explain the word love. Here are a few of their responses. "Love is when you tell a guy you like his shirt and then he wears it every day." Love is when you share your French fries and don't want somebody else's French fries in return. Love is like a little old woman and a little old man who are still friends after they even know each other so well. Love is when you kiss all the time. Then when you get tired of kissing and you still want to be together, you talk. My mommy and daddy are like that. They look gross kissing. You really shouldn't say, "I love you," unless you mean it. But if you mean it, you should say it a lot because people forget. Perhaps that's why there are over 500 references in the Bible to love. We forget. Love is when mommy gives daddy the best piece of chicken. Love is when your puppy licks you in the face even after you've left him alone all day. Importantly, when someone loves you, the way they say your name is different. You know that your name is safe in their mouth. May you hear your name whispered by the Holy, in whose mouth your name is utterly safe. And finally, if you want to learn to love better, you should start with a friend who you hate. This pandemic is revealing broken places in our society, in our government, in our world. Oh, that we would take advantage of this opportunity to right wrongs, to improve our systems, to be equitable and just for all of God's children. That we would indeed love more by loving God, loving God's amazing creation, loving our neighbors, our friends, and yes, even loving those we find difficult to love. How might we practice love? A 4-year-old child whose next-door neighbor, an elderly gentleman, had just lost his wife, was sitting on his porch crying. The little boy opened the gate and went into the gentleman's yard and crawled up in his lap and sat there. A while later, when he came back home, his mom asked him, "What did you say to the neighbor?" And the little boy said, "Nothing. I just helped him cry." How can you practice love? You can practice love by staying at home, or when you go out, by wearing a mask to show your regard for yourself and for your neighbors. You can donate money or time, if you are able, to causes that help people, to help those who are most in need. You can practice love by supporting efforts in climate control and other ways of respecting creation by recycling, reusing, and reducing. You might practice love by spending time focused on God, praying, meditating, listening, pondering. How will you heed Jesus' commandment even in the midst of uncertainty, fear, and anxiety? How will you practice love? Do practice. Do love. Do a little or do a lot, but do love.
Continuing on page 5 in our bulletins, let us say. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being, the other, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the life and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love, and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Scott, our own bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease, and that all may be one, as you and the Creator are one. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the Church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, especially Donald, our president, Greg, our governor, and Betsy, our mayor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this diocese, for those who are present and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health. Lord, hear our prayers for those we now name.
For Jean, Pete, Debbie, Bob.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord, our God. For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, now and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. And now on this Sunday, we want to recognize and celebrate those who are graduating. So I invite those who are graduating to stand. This day we pause to remember, give thanks for those among us who are graduating. Graduates, you have arrived at a crossroads, completing a section of your life's journey. Before you begin the new road, take a moment to turn around and remember all those who have accompanied you thus far. The teachers, the friends, those who have loved you, those who have challenged you, both for growth and for struggle.
Give thanks for everyone who has been in your life, for they are part of who you are, part of what makes you wonderful.
The road in front of you is full of dreams and hopes. As you step forward into this next part of your life's journey, may you discover the presence of the Creator in every moment. May you find hope in the midst of laughter and tears, in victory and defeat, in love and in loss.
We give you our blessings for next steps made in moments of certainty and in moments of trepidation. We give you our companionship in moments of friendship and in moments of loneliness. We give you our love in moments of abundance and in moments of emptiness.
The road in front of you is full of choices. Some will be clear, others murky. Some will rouse up honor and value, others injury and injustice. May you engage choice with a discerning heart.
Go forth courageously, knowing that God is always with you. And in moments of beneficial choosing and in moments of hurtful choosing, there is no place you can go where the love of God is not already waiting.
The road in front of you is filled with opportunity. May you grasp the perseverance and bravery to seize the unknown.
Just as the light of Christ shone forth along the way of Jesus, may you strew the light of Christ along your way.
Blessed God, you are the beginning of all things, the sustainer of all and the end of all. We give thanks for these new graduates, for the joy of accomplishment, for the struggle of failure, for the hope of springing forth in their hearts. As they stand at this crossroads of life, may they give thanks for the good things that have gone before. May they extend forgiveness for the injuries done to them. And may they accept forgiveness for the injuries they have done. What is done is done. Let it be. And now may the Spirit of the living God fill you, new graduate, with gifts and talents and empower you to use those for the betterment of creation. May she guide you along paths that are smooth, but not necessarily without challenge. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in this world so that you can do what others claim cannot be done.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.